For me, the best thing about Creative Computing Institute is the sense of community that we're creating. This is one of the few places in the world where you can see things from an arts perspective and also a science and technology perspective at the same time. And that means that together everyone is talking about something they can't really talk about anywhere else.
I studied at University of Arts London. I was like the techie person in like traditional design environments where maybe some of the things I needed or the spaces, the conversations I wanted to have did not exist. So when I knew that the CCI was being created, I was always trying to find ways on how I can get involved.
This is the first cohort of students in the program. I've been really impressed at how much they've taken the materials we've given them and made them their own.
Every time I come in the building, the students are just like chomping at the bit to show their work to people. I think it'll be a very, very good career for them.
So I'm showing my first project on the diploma. I thought it would be interesting to explore what if we could see in sound rather than light.
So I did the week-long machine learning course and the P5.js course with the CCI, and it's really helped me sort of develop my practice and teach me more of the development side of coding.
It's really changed my mind about like what computation is, what it means to the world, what it means like to society at large. Like, in the course of a year, I've like really changed how I'm thinking about it.
We have a beautiful mission and a great social agenda, and we really want to positively impact the way tech works in society.
I think of computing as a craft exercise, like pottery or weaving. It's going to take you a long time to become a master of it, but the first steps should be approachable by anyone. And I think that's an important part of what we do here at CCI.
Welcome everyone. Welcome to this open day session at the Creative Computing Institute. My name is Georgina Cadavila and I am the Creative Learning Producer at CCI. And today we are going to have a look at the MSc in Data Science and AI for the Creative Industries. And we've got with us Louis McCallum, who's the course leader of the MSc. And we also have with us Comora Love-Mitchell, who is a current student at the MSc. So just first of all, to give you a bit of an overview of how the session will run, we're going to start talking a little bit about the CCI, what spaces and facilities and resources are available to CCI students. Then we're going to hear from Louis about the course structure and units and the approach of this exciting new MSc at the Creative Computing Institute. And then we'll have the chance to hear from Comora about her experience being part of the course and undertaking this MSc. So at the end, we all going to have a quick chat, an informal chat about our experience running the course, but also we are open to any questions that you might have about the Institute, about the course, about the application process, whatever comes to your mind, please feel free to just pop a message on the chat and we'll do our best to cover it all at the Q&A session at the end. So just as a note on accessibility, the platform that we're using today, Blackboard Collaborate, doesn't display live captions. So if you have difficulties following along the session or you miss any detail, don't worry because the session is being recorded. And after this event, we will send you a link that you can access anytime to rewatch the session or just go through the content. So yes, don't worry at all if you miss any bit of the session today. So let's get this started. I'm going to start playing a video that myself I recorded talking a little bit more about the CCI in more detail. I hope you enjoyed and we'll see you back in a second. Hi everyone. In this video, we're going to show you around the campus and share some of the facilities and resources available to CCI students. The Creative Computing Institute is located at UAL's Peckham Road campus in Camberwell, South East London. The local area is home to a thriving art scene, which hosts a variety of art galleries and artist studios that students, graduates, and staff work and exhibit in. On site, there are two galleries, Camberwell Space and the Student Union Gallery, with the South London Gallery right next door and Peckham Platform in the local area. Also, on site, we have an amazing library supported by a dedicated CCI librarian, who oversees the subject area of creative computing ensuring the library stays up to date with the books, periodicals, databases, and other resources you need to complete your studies. The CCI is located across the 4th and 5th floor of the newest building at Peckham Road, which means it's very accessible to students with various needs. Let's take a look around. The CCI is divided into four main areas. At the heart of the space is the kitchen. At lunchtime, it becomes a social hub of CCI for folks to share lunch together, and during classes, it's quite a working space. Along the side are three classrooms, two seminar rooms, and one high-end computer suite fitted with some of the latest technology, including 24 high-spec computers with NVIDIA RTX 2080 graphics cards and 4K monitors for working on projects ranging from machine learning to 3D rendering and video editing. Additionally, many of these computers can actually be accessed remotely from home after hours to enable access to specialist software or the high performance for rendering or machine learning work. In addition to the computing facilities, we have dedicated spaces set up for electronics, soldering, 3D printing, and virtual reality facilities. Elsewhere within the building, CCI students have access to the 3D workshop, which includes additional 3D printing facilities, laser cutting, CNC machining, and a full wood workshop. We take COVID-19 safety very seriously, so at the moment, our spaces are reconfigured to enable students to spread out 2 meters apart. There's also loads of windows to ensure good ventilation and hand and surface sanitizer throughout the space to keep things clean, on top of regular visits from cleaning staff. In normal times, we also operate a laptop locker system where students can borrow a laptop to use within the CCI spaces. This is just a glimpse of the amazing resources and facilities that are going to be available for you while studying at CCI. Now, I would like to briefly talk about the CCI social mission and public program. At CCI, we aim to integrate computational thinking with approaches to fairness and equality for the UAL and wider community. This is formally codified through our social mission, which focuses on diversity in technology, digital inclusion, and entrepreneurship. Our public program is underpinned by this mission and connects students, practitioners, and researchers with an international community of creative computing professionals. The aim of the public program is to offer a platform where UAL students, staff, and industry people can explore creative technology through workshops, public events, intensive courses, and fellowships awarded to practitioners in the field. To give you a sense of what you have the chance to take part in while studying at CCI, here are some of the programs that we've run. CCI's inaugural fellowship in 2018 was awarded to Feminist Internet. We run a series of workshops exploring the idea of a feminist Alexa. Our second fellowship was awarded to creativeapplications.net, in which we delved into creative coding with custom LED displays and innovative ways to apply to new technologies. CCI awarded its third fellowship to artist and researcher Anna Riddler. Together, we ran a learning program called Artificial AI, where we explored some of the problematics embedded in datasets. In parallel, we've run several week-long intensive courses open to all UAL students, which included inclusive design in wearable technology, designing a feminist chatbot, computational thinking with P5.js, machine learning for the creative industries, design with data and interactive machine learning, and the latest one we run, querying voice AI transcendental design. We also started the CCI After School Club, now renamed Tech Yard, a safe space aimed at young people, families, and beginners based in the local area in Peckham and Camberwell, who want to learn creative computing in a supportive environment. This is just a quick overview of all the opportunities that we've been able to provide to UAL and CCI students over the last 2 years. But there are so many exciting things that are on the way and that we cannot wait for you to take part in. Thanks so much for watching and listening. I hope you enjoyed what you just seen. And now let's keep moving. Hello again. I hope you found that useful. So next item up is a video that Louis recorded for you in which he will share everything you need to know about the MSc in creative in data science and AI for the creative industries before moving to the live conversation. So I hope you enjoy it and We'll see you after this video.
Hello and welcome to this introduction video for the Creative Computing Institute Open Day 2020-2021. I don't know what we're calling it. Anyway, next year. My name's Louis McCallum. I'm the course leader for the MSc Data Science and AI for the Creative Industries. We're a new course this year. So you'll be looking to come and join the second cohort, which is exciting. I'm just going to do you a quick presentation now where I'll show you the kind of people we're taking onto the course, the kind of environment you'll be working in, the kind of things you'll be learning, and the kind of stuff you hope will hopefully let you go on to be once you've learned some skills on this course. By the way, you'll see my face change colour as I change slide because I've got some quite big block bold colours and I'm in a dark room. So my lots of different colour effects to my skin as I change through. That's just me changing slides. Pink. Okay, so who are we taking onto the course? We offer BA in Arts and Humanities graduates the opportunity to re-enter their studies in an applied STEM discipline in a creative industries context. What does that mean? So basically what we're talking about here is it's a conversion master's. Although it's an MSc, and we'll teach you lots of technical stuff, we'll teach you maths, we'll teach you the statistics, we'll teach you the programming, we'll teach you the platforms. Everyone that we take on is going to come from BA in Arts Humanities graduates. And I think this is the right way around to do it. It's important with how much data science affects everyone in their lives. And quite what kind of often happens now is we take people from tech backgrounds and like who have done years of computer science or maths, Silicon Valley types, and then we go, we're gonna teach you a bit of ethics, teach you to quickly think about stuff. You've kind of got to retrofit all these years of critically thinking that just comes naturally for arts and humanities students. So that's kind of why this course exists, or one of the reasons anyway. So this year, what have we got? We've got people from art history backgrounds, people from fashion backgrounds, people from design backgrounds, people from normal art practice backgrounds, people from film backgrounds, people from the social sciences, older people, younger people. It's a real diverse group and they're all amazing. So I can't wait for you to join them. So yeah, that's who we're expecting, what you're gonna learn. So we're gonna aim to give you opportunity to learn computer and data science skills. So data science is pretty, as we said, ubiquitous it's being used in all industries to analyze data, provide insights which then companies can act on. So in the fashion industry or the music industry, it's also being used to generate loads of stuff in the creative industries. So generative pictures, generative art, generative music, architecture, that kind of stuff, all kinds of crazy stuff. And it all sits on this background being able to use computers and data science. And we're gonna teach you how to do that. We don't expect you to have any programming skills when you come, although it does kind of help. We do have people that have started this year with zero coding background. So we'll assume that as a minimum. We'll spend the first part building everybody up to the same level, and then we'll move on from there into the as things get more complicated. So we really welcome a diverse range of backgrounds. All you've got to be is enthusiastic. And we'll reorient your skills. So what's a data scientist? One part statistician, one part computer scientist, and I've only got two hands. One part domain expert, actually three parts. So we can teach you the stats, we can teach you the computer science. You bring your domain expertise. You know things, you know stuff about the creative industries, and that's valuable knowledge. So we'll give you the practical skills to go in and go back to your industries and be able to analyze text and analyze fashion and design new buildings based on an architecture based on data analysis, write new books based on literature, if that's your jam. So you've got the domain skills, which is super valuable, and will give you the stats and computer science skills to go out and make a difference. So I'll just do you a quick overview of the course and what you learn, what the structure is. So it's a 45-week master's. We start in late September, early October. There's three terms of learning, each with two courses each. So that's one shorter course and one big chunky course. We really get into a lot of detail. So that's six things you'll really learn a lot of stuff about. And then once you've built yourself up to be an amazing creative data scientist, you have the summer to do your thesis project, to really get your teeth into something that you love, or something you're passionate about, something you want to research more, to do a really good substantial piece of work. Okay, so I'll go through each of the courses now. Unit one, STEM for creatives. So this is a course we run in the first term. It's kind of interesting to think of it as a kind of science, technology, maths boot camp. So as we say, we take people from a really wide variety of backgrounds. So we use this course to get everyone up to the same level. So we'll teach you about the maths that underpins a lot of the data science endeavors. We'll teach you some programming. It's going to be mainly Python for those who are interested, because this is what is used in industry. We mainly taught by me. I'm from a kind of creative computer science background, but I've worked in the creative industries as well. We'll teach you how to work with audio, how to get information from audio, so it can then put it into models and train models on it, how to get data from human interaction, so how to analyze videos, how to analyze sensor data, how to work with images and all the maths that goes along with that. So it'll just be an introduction that'll pull everyone up to the same level, so everyone knows how to work with all these cool different mediums of data that are relevant to the creative industries. So then when we move on, you're going to have the real skills to work on it. Okay, we also run a natural language processing course in the first term. So this is our real first look at taking a body of data, this time the medium is text, trying to pull some insights out of that using data analysis techniques. So we'll look at stuff like text analysis, text generation. So you've probably seen a lot of these largely trained data generation models generating really plausible sentences and like over long, you know, stories which have beginnings, middles and ends, stuff that you wouldn't have really thought of a long time ago. So we'll look at how these work, simpler methods for, you know, chat, how you build Twitter bots that say funny things on the internet. So how these fit into things like chatbots that are used a lot in industry, conversational interfaces for things like Siri and Alexa, how those things fit together. What you see here on the left, this lovely diagram is from people at The Pudding. They do loads of amazing data journalism. The URL is just there. I suggest you check them out. So they did this amazing piece where they looked at 100 years of literature and looked at how people talked about parts of the body and where the biases were between how people talked about men's bodies and women's bodies, the words they used and the parts of the bodies they talked about. And they used natural language processing to comb through this big data set of loads of novels and come up with these really interesting insights and presented it in this beautiful way. I suggest you check it out. So we'll be looking here at how you can get nice, interesting insights from big sets of text data. Ready for us, we move on to the next course after Christmas. We have our first introduction to data science and machine learning. So we'll teach you the statistics that goes in behind this, how to build data sets, how to think about data sets, where does your data come from? I'm really going to push ethics throughout this course. So you, rather than critically just, you know, taking troves of data that's just generated from everything we do these days, and then analyzing it and then using it to control stuff and to make decisions about our lives. I'm really going to push people to think about, where does the data come from? What was the complicity in this? What was the consent in this? Did people really know that their data was going to be used in this way? How, you know, was it taken in one way and then sold to a lot of people? And also, how are the models used? Who benefits, who loses out? What are the power structures there? And also, again, a lot of practical skills and how to do interesting things with data. And this image here, sorry, is a classic example of a classification problem. So you have two sets of labeled data and you want to try and identify whether it's one's one thing or another thing. In this case, what type of robot are you? Okay, so we'll also look at how you can use artificial intelligence to generate and analyze media. This is something which has come on leaps and bounds in the last 5 years, ever since the advent of deep learning. So you'll have probably seen a lot of videos and images generated and people going, this face isn't real, but it looks real. This cat isn't real, but it looks real. We'll look at how people can generate audio, in raw audio and music, in a symbolic form. A lot of interesting stuff's come out of Google in the last 5 years or so from the Magenta Research Group. We have quite a strong partnership with them. So we'll see some interesting stuff in that thing. You may have seen approaches such as style transfer, where people take the stylistic components of one set of videos or pictures and overlay them to another. So I could be talking and you can make me look like an oil painting or like a Japanese painting, or yeah, any other kind of style on top of that. Stuff with lip syncing and deep fakes, we've seen a lot more again in recent years, and I think this will continue to be a big thing. So you can learn about those things and a lot of these video processing things are making their way into commercial products. The most recent version of Adobe has all these video processing effects that are deep learning models under the background. We'll also learn about GANs, you may have heard of these things, things which generate faces and do weird stuff. So that's going to be an exciting course. We have lots of world-leading researchers working on these kind of things at the CCI, to how to analyze and generate new media with applications in music, architecture, fashion, general art practice, design, loads of stuff. Okay, so then after we've built up our skills, by the time we get to term three, we'll have quite a industry-focused course where we'll look at case studies in how we can use these things in the data, our data science skills in the creative industries. I've just pulled this thing from, I think, government website, identifying the creative industries, which is a massive sector in the UK. Advertising, as identified by Mr. Bean, of course. Architecture, arts and culture, craft, design, fashion, games, music, publishing, TV and film, as represented by an orange block. And we've also got the stock photo of someone doing VR, which of course is standard. So we've got lots of media, we've got lots of industry contacts. We'll help and we'll get them integrated in this course to really give you a good insight into how the skills are used in the creative industries. And then finally, we'll be looking at how companies in the creative industry used machine learning to analyze what their customers are doing, how they're consuming things, and then use that to personalize interfaces and then push recommendations back. So places like Spotify, Netflix, when they you finish watching a film, they recommend you something else, Amazon, all of these things. So not just how do you take all of this data that they collect from people and get interesting insights from it, but also how do you then take these insights and then update the experience that users have in order to change the outcomes and the experiences that they're having and the things that they're buying. If you look at, say, there's a guy called Francois Pache at Spotify who looks at generating music. Not only does he know all of the songs that people listen to, He knows what parts of the songs they stop at, what parts they skip. He uses that information to then generate new songs. So you can really get into this really fine-grained detail, which is then passed on to further generate new content or change users' experiences. That's what we'll learn about in Unit 6. And then we'll move on to the research section. At the CCI, we don't just have amazing teaching and courses. We've got tons of world-leading research happening among the faculty themselves in stuff like media generation, human-focused machine learning, game design, general media performance stuff. There's also a bunch of PhD students doing really interesting research, more of an early stage. So there's a real bustling research community. So when you're here and you're at the CCI, you'll be able to interact with these people, see the work that they're doing, be around opportunities for collaboration and inspiration. They hold weekly meetings on Wednesday. You can just go in, stick your nose in, and just see what else is going on in here. Hopefully that'll give you inspiration for moving in on all of your other talk courses that you do. The Creative Computing Institute itself, obviously you know something about it since you're here for the open day. People sometimes say that they wish these things had been around when they're young. Like, I wish the school had been like this when I was a kid, or I wish these courses had been available when I was a student. Which is true for this. I really wish it was. But it doesn't really quite make sense here. That's just because, like, the leaps and bounds that have come on in interdisciplinary research in the last, I don't know, 15 years to where we are now, to becoming this really accepted thing that you could have an MSc computer, you know, data science program being taught within an art school. That kind of thing is so valuable and so relevant with the kind of the ubiquitousness of technology into all forms of life and works and stuff. Yeah, something like this just couldn't have accepted for, and the people that are really on the forefront of pushing these interdisciplinary approaches to research, loads of them actually work at the CCI now. And it's a real bastion of that, and a real kind of shining light of what's possible when you combine different approaches from different academic backgrounds and practical skill learning to really make amazing academics and students to go on to do really cool things. So that can be you. Also, just in general, the technology, a lot of the stuff that we look at, the fact that you can do it at all, the fact that you can do it to the quality you can, the fact that you can do it on your own computer, the fact that you can run a lot of this stuff in browsers is insane. Like, it blows my mind. Stuff that like 5 years ago would have been unthinkable. So again, there's a real chance for these technologies to be integrated into industries, into context, and just it just wasn't at all possible. So it's a really exciting time for this course to exist. So like I say, yeah, I wish this would have been around when I was a kid, but it definitely couldn't have been when I was a student. It's a real course of our time, and hopefully we'll give you the skills to go out and have an effect on the upcoming world. We often have a lot of guest lectures coming in, so there's a focus on working with people from industry. We had someone from Cambridge the other day speaking, someone from BBC R&D coming in next week. Got someone who works with analysing chatbots for disinformation, who does work with the UN, coming in at the end of the term. So we've got a lot of amazing voices at the CCI, and we also bring in loads of external industry ones to contribute to that as well. We want you to get jobs, and this may seem like an obvious point, and we'll take it at like face value. We're going to teach you the skills that you need to get jobs, the skills that you need to work with the state-of-the-art technologies and the jobs in the industry that are out there. The programming skills, the math skills, the knowledge. But we also want to get you jobs, because then you'll be working in these places. As data is being generated at a massive level, it's super important that the people that are working in these companies have the kind of wherewithal and the critical thinking and the ethical thinking to really make decisions about what's done with data, what's done with data, what's done with models, and should we be doing these things? How do we do them right? So we take you, who come with your arts and your humanities backgrounds, you've had years of training to think critically and properly about stuff. We give you the data science skills, then you can go into these companies, really make sure that what they're doing is done right. And that's important. Also, if you want a quick just like primer about what we're doing, me, Rebecca Freebrink, and Mick Grayson, all at the CCI, have an online course at Future Learn called Applied Creative Machine Learning. Requires no programming, all in JavaScript, all runs in a browser. And if you want a quick insight into the kind of fun stuff you might be able to do at quite a simple level with machine learning in your creative practice, check it out.
Hello again. Thanks, Louis, for such a lovely video. That was super informative. Now, I would like to welcome you and Comora to this virtual space. So if you want to turn on your cameras and audience, we would love to hear from you. So now we have around 10 minutes to 15 minutes to hear some bits about Comora's experience being part of the MSC. So let's see. Hi, Comora. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm doing well. So this is my first semester as part of the MSc program, which has definitely been, a challenge just because I am coming from a creative field. Like Louis said, a lot of us come with no knowledge of programming or coding, and I was definitely one of those people. I just obtained a degree in art history from the Courtauld. So I definitely came into this program more wanting to see what technology and data science and AI could offer, specifically for me, the art field. So it's been a really good opportunity kind of coming in and starting from the ground up, learning about coding and text generators and web scraping and pretty much everything possible that you could think of for this program. And Louis and Rebecca, who's another of our lecturers, has done a really good job integrating us into kind of this course and teaching us and, you know, not getting irritated if we ask extremely basic questions, but really going through it with us and making sure that we all understand and that we're learning it, you know, not a slow pace, but a pace that is good for all of us. And I think I definitely came into it a little bit nervous because it was completely online for part of it. And then a couple days once a week, we would go in person. And I was kind of, you know, concerned of how the integration would work with being online. And just because most of us have never done online university before, but I think the university did a really great job of doing that blended learning to kind of help build that community that even though part of the time we were online, it still was extremely interactive. Using breakout groups has been really great. Also, even though we've had to sit, you know, socially distance apart when we are inside of the building, it's still been easy to kind of communicate and talk and, you know, learn from each other, even though we are a little bit further away. So I think that's been really great. I think one of my favorite activities has been doing the journal club, which we actually just did this morning for class, where we kind of discuss and read academic papers. And that's given me the chance to kind of see the context outside of the technical skills that we're learning and seeing the broader picture and where you can take the skills that we're learning and how you can apply them and what you can do with them, which I think has been really interesting. So it's definitely helped me to kind of feel just a little bit more ready and able to see the directions that I could go with certain projects, with different tasks that we have and assignments, that it makes it so you have a base line of what to see and what to do. And yeah, so I also have think that it's been a challenging time for me to, you know, learn and do all of the resources online, and just coming from not knowing much of the information. So I think they've done a great job at providing us with a lot of extra material that we can do in our own time, which I think has been really beneficial to this program, just because it's a lot of information at once, obviously. So it's been good to be able to kind of take a step back. They give you a lot of readings and links and things that you can look at so that we can build our own knowledge, or if we want to go deeper into a certain, you know, interest that we talked about or a certain aspect that we briefly covered, then they'll give us the information so that we can go forward and look through it all. So yeah, so I think it's been a really good experience so far.
That's amazing. Thank you so much, Comora.
Thank you so much, Comora. And I'm glad you're enjoying yourself, having a good time. How have you found the other students that on the course? Are you managing to get on with them?
Yeah, I think it's been good. I think it is mostly because we're a lot closer in age than I was with the last set of postgrads that I was with at the Quartal, that they were all a bit older than I was. So it definitely, like, we had things to talk about, but I definitely think that it's easier to connect with these people. Also because we're all coming from the same spot of never having done a lot of the technical stuff. So there's, you know, the solidarity in that we've grown closer because of it. So yeah, so everyone's been really nice, really welcoming. That's been really great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's nice because in this first year we have a reasonably small cohort. I think there's 12 people, mm-hmm. which is nice. It lets you all get to know each other, and also lets me get to know everyone as well, which is nice. It's almost more like a PhD cohort than an MSc program in that respect. And then you mentioned a little bit about your background from a kind of art history background. What is it do you have much of a sense yet of what you'd like to go on to do with the stuff you learn here?
I'm still kind of grappling with it, but I definitely want to use technology to kind of more integrate the art world into a technological space, just because I think, especially with COVID, when everything went online, it really kind of showed the gaps in the industry, that it definitely is a more in-person field. And so it kind of was a lot of people that I were talking to were kind of scrambling to put everything online to kind of see how they could make art fairs virtual, auctions going online, different things, art buying on online marketplaces. So I think that was one of the main things that kind of made me think about, okay, this could be an interesting thing to look into, of kind of merging the technological side with the traditionally in-person art. And yeah, so I thought that would be really interesting. It also just helps, you know, make the art world more accessible and more transparent than it has been in the past. So again, with your whole concept of ethics, making things better for everyone, that was a huge selling point.
Yeah, I think it's, yeah, for sure. I think that, yeah, there's a lot of stuff which is kind of already interestingly happening in the art world. It's one on the generation side, like we've seen in the last couple of years, the artworks generated using machine learning coming up for sale in Christie's and Sotheby's, which is stuff that but we'll cover in the second unit, like the second term of the course. And stuff especially that people at the CCI, especially like Grierson, for example, is quite up there in kind of world-leading research in doing that kind of generative stuff. And also, art market's also an interesting one. there's quite a burgeoning cryptocurrency art scene at the moment, with people saying digital art and blockchains and stuff, which is quite nice. Kind of on that wider thing, have you been attending much of the research sessions? Have you managed to integrate with any of the other CCI communities outside of the course?
I haven't been able to yet, mostly just because I'm still trying to learn all of this information, but I try to see, hear different talks when I look at them. I have all of the Slack channels open for seeing different things that I'll kind of sign up for, see if I want to listen to. But yeah, I'm still looking at everything.
Cool, thank you very much. Maybe it's time for some questions, perhaps, Georgina.
Yes, I would encourage everyone here in the room to just send us any question, comment, doubt that you have about the course that you would like to ask Louis or Comora. Please do send them through. In the meantime, while we wait until someone reaches out, I would love to hear, Comora, about what is the experience of sharing this space with people, bringing so many different domains into the classroom? Because it has to be a very kind of rich experience to be able to learn from scratch, creative computing, but everyone just bringing their own backgrounds, their own interests. That is quite a unique space, I think, for someone to be learning in. So how are you finding it? What is your experience being part of the?
Yeah, it has been really interesting. I think one of the good things of, having such a small cohort of people is that even though it's small, I'm pretty sure every single person in the class is coming from a different perspective and a different background. So it's been really nice, especially with the journal clubs when we're talking, of kind of seeing, the way we're thinking and if there's ever an overlap with, future research that we're interested in or how it pertains to something that we want to do in the future. And it's always interesting to hear those sides from other people when they're talking to us about, oh, this is how this kind of pertains to the stuff that I'm interested in, or, when they were doing their past dissertations or their final projects in their previous courses, kind of how that was integrated with what we're doing now, or similar ways of how they were thinking about it. So I found it really interesting because it definitely broadens your perspective of things like, oh, I never thought that it could be used in this way, or that, text could be used to do these different activities. And so, yeah, it's been really interesting.
That's great. And is there anything, if you could go back in time and talk to the Comora back then before applying to this course, is there anything that you would have loved to hear about the course, about the experience, about being part of the CCI that maybe now you can provide to all of these people in the room interested in the MSc?
I definitely would say, I guess maybe not so much something that I didn't do, but I definitely would say getting involved with things and, reaching out to everyone on the list that you see, just kind of to, create connections, makes it easier when you're first coming into the course, especially to maybe get to know some people, especially when we have our open days that we had our welcome week, kind of talking to the people there, just reaching out, honestly, I think is probably one of the best things.
That's great. That's great. I also had here a note. I think something that you brought up, Comora, was about the blended learning. So I was thinking maybe, Louis, if you could maybe explain in a bit more detail what is the blended learning method that we're using and how exactly the sessions are run and how does that work? That would be great.
Yeah, so we have a kind of rotation, 3-week rotation happening at the moment. So we only have one group of students in the CCI space at the time, which means that we're all in our own little separate bubble. What that means is, of the 3 classes that everyone has every week, you get 1 class every 3 weeks in person. So So you kind of get a nice rotation on that. Obviously, all of the data science students are all in the same units together, so they get to see each other every week. But the kind of the context of what course that's in is different each week. We tend to split the when we're in person, because we can't all be in like one lecture room because of social distancing. And also some people are still online, like people who are quarantining or that kind of thing. We tend to do kind of smaller groups. So I'll move around between people while they kind of work on tasks in smaller groups. And then there'll be some people online that I'll check in on as well. And then the online sessions we have, we'll spend them watching lectures and then we'll have some question and answers. As Comora said, we sometimes do like breakout groups. So even on the fully online sessions, we still try and keep some group work going and try and keep people interacting together, working on documents together, presenting work back to the group, that kind of thing. It's all worked really nicely. I've become an expert in recording. I've got the professional microphone. Don't know how that's going.
Amazing. Thanks, Louis. We have a question from Kimia. They're asking whether it's possible for them to apply to the course with a baccalaureate in industrial engineering and a fashion background as well.
I think that sounds pretty great. We say it's a bit like a BA conversion, but definitely if you have other more technical things and an interest in creative work in general, I think this is probably ideal for you. I think a lot of the maths and probably a bit of the engineering that gets maybe even do a bit of programming in engineering degrees these days as well. So I think all of that will totally be useful. And if you've got an interest, we've got people with fashion backgrounds on the course at the moment. Someone who does work with I think like fashion photography and fashion design. So he's looking at interesting ways to generate new designs for fashion using kind of by modeling big data sets and generating new images and stuff. So yeah, I think that's totally appropriate.
Yeah, it sounds actually a very exciting mix of expertise for sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, amazing. So I was wondering, maybe Comora, you would like to share with us what projects you're working on at the moment? Is that something you'd be happy to share?
Yeah, well, currently we're working on our different assignments. So our assignment for week 7, which was this past week, is to do some imaging and audio that we've been learning about, which is definitely pretty difficult, but it's been helpful to kind of, they give us a time in class to work on it, and then we also have a while to work on it on our own time, but it's pretty straightforward with having to do with all of the information that we've covered. But I'm still working on it at the moment. So not much to report on how it's going.
How about from the stuff we've looked at already, or like this, some of the stuff that's coming up, is there anything that you're particularly excited about? Like either in courses, like things that we've done, or like courses that you know that are coming up?
Well, I'm pretty excited for the final project, because that just seems really interesting. So for the final project for this semester, we get to, kind of look at our own mini project with text and see kind of what we can come up with and what we can do. So I'm currently researching some different areas, things that I could possibly be doing, but it's definitely helpful to kind of have had those papers that we've read in the past to kind of see ideas, and then they've also given us some project examples that could be something. So I think that's more the most interesting part, is researching the possibilities for me.
Yeah, lovely. So this is in the natural language processing course that we do in the first year. So the students have one kind of technical project to do where they get to kind of pick an area where they'll use some of the like language processing techniques to kind of get some collect together a data set and try and get some insight into like a big group of data, pull some interesting information out, or maybe try some modeling techniques to then generate some new stuff or design a chatbot. And then there's also a critical essay side of it as well. So as well as just making things, the students have to kind of situate what they've made in the context of other research or maybe other artistic practice, and kind of show that they can not only build stuff, but like maybe evaluate how well it's done, the task it's done, and compare different techniques to each other, and to kind of building not just the technical skills of how you make these, but also thinking about how you can reflect on exactly how well it is what you're doing. And that's not always as straightforward as like, you know, yes, right or not, right or wrong. There are often several different ways you can like evaluate the performance of something, depending on your goals, especially in a creative industry. So I'm really looking forward to those essays.
That sounds great. Cool. So what's other exciting lectures are coming up now for MSU students, Louis?
What are we doing? We're doing, this week we've got, tomorrow, there's one of the postdoc students is doing a talk about, he's done a project of generative hip hop lyrics. So he's going to talk about that. And Rebecca's going to talk about dialogue systems as well, I think, so like question and answer systems, which I think has a lot of stuff, interesting stuff going on. Then next week we've got Vince Lynch from a company called Ivy.ai, who do loads of stuff with a lot of text analysis and general social media analysis, from more kind of straightforward marketing kind of stuff, but then also they do a lot of kind of goodwill things. So he's worked with the UN before. So he's going to show us a lot of case studies of projects that they work on. So I think that'll be super interesting because it will situate a lot of the learning, and it will show a lot of like real world situations that someone that kind of runs a pretty big company actually uses these techniques for. But also he'll show how you can deploy it. These things kind of at scale, because it's not like doing things in like a research context and doing things in a commercial context, like technically, is always kind of provides some kind of unique technical challenges. We were talking to him the other day, and so when we in the class, when we're building Twitter data sets, we literally just scrape the website, as it were. But he was talking about this thing, if you want the full like Twitter stream, it's called the fire hose. Which kind of gives the impression of like how much data is coming at you, if you want full access to that, you have to pay them for it. But that's the kind of speed and scale that he's working at, is like hundreds of thousands of tweets a day. So I think that'll be interesting to hear about.
That sounds exciting. Amazing. Is there any other questions from the audience? Please feel free to ask away. Now we have a few minutes left. In the meantime, is there anything else you would like to cover, Louis or Comora, share with attendees today?
Yeah, I mean, if people want to ask me questions about more stuff about applying, application process, about how assessments work, or things we might cover in the course, happy to cover any of that. Maybe I can talk a bit more about assessments, because people are usually interested in that, especially if you come from different backgrounds. We tend to have a mix of both in-class projects, which is nice. I think open-ended projects are always quite nice, especially when you have a mix of like a diverse background of people, because it means that people can pick the area that they're interested in, or take something that they're already interested in, and then use the stuff that they've learned in the course to kind of further pursue that. So as much as possible, we try and do quite like open briefs for projects, person exams. We do them as, because of coronavirus, we do them as open book exams online, which means that rather than kind of spending 2 weeks like revising, memorizing things for your exam, the questions are kind of assume that you have access to all of your notes and to the internet and stuff. So they're more a test of like understanding rather than just knowledge. So I think whilst there are exams, I know some people like exams, some people don't like exams. I think that if you have struggled with the kind of traditional exams in the past, I think maybe this will be a better setup for you.
Thanks, Louis. We have a question from Ryan. They're asking, what's the difference between the MSc in Creative Computing course that we also offer and the one that we're discussing today, and whether this one is a bit more research-led?
I think probably not. I think all of the master's course engage with like existing research on quite and encourage like a lot of your own like research of other people's work and academic work, and then kind of bringing that back into your work in the classes, and both of them end up with a dissertation project in the end as well. There's a creative computing MRes, which is more research focused, and that's more of a kind of gateway towards a PhD. The focus of that, so that will teach you more like specific research methods and stuff. And the final project is longer and takes more weights. The creative computing MSc here, I would say the main difference is it's more practice focus. So you might learn similar-ish skills, but it may be more in the context of using these things in your own maybe artistic or musical practice, as opposed to this course, which maybe it's just a bit more vocational. Not that like a creative practice is not a vocational thing, but we might, we're probably maybe looking more at a kind of wider scope of the creative industries rather than just the kind of more traditional practice-based ones.
So just a note that we're running the open day for the MSc in Creative Computing on Thursday in the morning, and then we are running the first graduation show at CCI. So we have the first cohort of students from the MSc graduating this year, and we're going to show all the student work on Thursday and Friday evening. So Ryan, if you want to jump online and watch this event, I think that will give you a better understanding probably of what's the difference and what sort of projects could emerge from both courses. So I would encourage you to book a slot in there. I'm just going to paste the link there as well. And yeah, we still have a few minutes left. Do you want to maybe, Louis, talk a little bit about the application process before we go? And this way we cover pretty much everything.
Let me just take a quick. So in terms of the application process, we're super open to a wide range of people applying. If you have concerns about whether this is the course for you and whether you have whether it's the appropriate background, please do get in touch. I guess you can email me or Ben Kelly, I guess. Do you know who the appropriate people to email will be? Jordina, if you can. Well, there's probably a general CCI email address to email.
Yes, I will send it.
So we really want to take a wide range of people. As Comora said, we've had some people with a wide range of technical and other creative backgrounds applying. So I think the only thing you really need to think about for applying is, what we want to see in your application is that you're enthusiastic about the kind of the techniques that you are looking at, and you're willing to kind of dive into these new skills. And then maybe you have you may not have an idea of what it is exactly that you want to do with the skills that you'll teach, you're learning. And hopefully you'll get a feel for that by the end.
Thank you. Yeah, I think we made it to the end of the session. It's 5 p.m. In the UK. So yeah, all it's left to say is thanks, Louis and Comora, for joining us online today. It was great to hear from you and hear more about the course. I already pasted the CCI's general email on the chat, so please feel free to reach out if you have any further questions about the course or CCI. We'll do our best to answer them. And yes, hopefully we'll see you in real life soon. Otherwise, in another open day session or the graduate showcase on Thursday. So yeah, thanks everyone. Hope you have a lovely evening.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thanks,
Josie. Yeah, thanks, Comora.
Bye.
Bye.
How is my learning journey or experience going at CCI? So I'll be very honest, my learning journey or experience at CCI did not start with this course. I've been part of UAL. I knew Ben Stoffer. He's the one who actually wrote my bachelor's course. So my journey actually started when the institute began. I've been involved with a lot of courses and a lot of tutors from the institute. And I've admired people with multidisciplinary backgrounds coming together in this space. So it's been a great journey, and that's why I am here, part of the institute today. The most surprising thing about the MSc, it's the fact that I thought like the things that would be so difficult would really bother me, but they're difficult but intriguing at the same time. Just thinking about so many things you can achieve by putting these tools in a very different context than what they've been imagined for, and that has been the most surprising thing with the MSc. Because most people, when they hear the word MSc, they think a lot of coding or a lot of technical skills and not a lot of fun. Whereas if you were doing an MFA, it's more like exploring and having a creative practice, but that's not the case. You get to explore and think in a very different way, and it's still quite interesting. My favorite thing about the institute, I think I've mentioned this before, is the fact that people with so many disciplines, so many different disciplines coming together. You can find people doing physical computing and implementing that in so many different ways, and other skill sets coming together. That's just so much more fun for me, because I've always been like, I don't want to be confined in one box or one discipline. I want to explore a lot of different spaces and then focus it using one lens. So that's sort of all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eti. I might just follow up on a couple of things there as well. How have you found your the other people on the course? Obviously, there's limited chance to meet people because of the restrictions due to COVID and stuff. But how have you found the other classmates?
I think it's been a very, very welcoming environment for me. I've gotten a chance to have people from so many different backgrounds, and there are quite a few people that already have quite developed practices or people working in these industries, but they want to apply these skill sets in a different way. So that sort of thing has been quite interesting and it's been welcoming. And I've also gotten a chance to learn from other people's perspective, because sometimes someone will ask a question in class coming from a completely different background, and that's going to be like, why did I never think of this? And maybe things can be done in this way. So those sort of things and those conversations are really interesting.
Yeah, and I think we try to present the work and the assignments in kind of open ways that allow people to kind of be flexible with their own approaches, which I think is nice. And also, I've seen you in some of the research meetings as well, with the kind of listening to PhD students and the research talks. Have you found that?
I think that has been the most interesting bit for me, because I initially wanted to, before going into a technical master's, I wanted to do more like do MRes. So that has been the most intriguing part, hearing people and getting a taste of what a PhD might be like or what other topics I can explore, because that is sort of my goal, to move to the PhD. So that has been quite an interesting space, because you learn about like the cutting edge research that's happening. And the best part is you can even get involved with those people within their research and get a chance to learn from them. There are people, for example, doing like Angus is doing his research with Google. And that's quite an interesting practice. Angus has also actually taught me on my bachelor's. So, you know, getting involved with these people again, it's just really fun for me.
Cool. Yeah, thank you very much. And I guess like most people in the course, you came with not tons of tech, like you worked in the technology area, but didn't necessarily have much technical skills. How have you found kind of learning that side?
So my technical skills were more like limited in terms of creating MVPs and stuff, and having like an understanding of technology and how the code is working, but I've never like written like full-fledged code. So that has been quite a different journey for me. I wouldn't say it's been one of the best journeys, like a very easy one, because again, this is a conversion master's. So things like sort of go quite a bit fast paced. It's not as slow as you would imagine it to be, but I wouldn't say it's a bad experience, because it's also not boring. And you have so many things right now going on, like I'm gaining so many skills. And I think the way it goes fast paced, it also gives you to think about how you can put quite a few things together, which you might not do if you're doing it in a slow paced environment, because then you're just focused on one particular topic.
Yeah, exactly. I think we have this interesting thing where I think it's always nice to expose people to stuff at first. You don't necessarily have to understand all parts of it. And I think rather than if you had a course where we said we're going to spend 2 months learning programming in like in a really abstract way and then teach you how to use it, I think it's not as interesting as if you immediately start showing people what the point of learning this stuff is, trying to get people using real data sets in real contexts, and then you kind of pick up the programming kind of as you're going along. It's nice. Yeah, I think that is really lovely to hear from you, Irtiza. I don't know if you have any more questions you'd like to ask Georgina.
It would be amazing. Just encourage all the attendees in the room to ask us any questions you might want us to cover. If you have any particular question for Irtiza about his experience, to Louis about the course, to myself about CCI, it's the perfect chance to do so. So I would really encourage you to ask us anything you want. And yeah, in the meantime, maybe we could, I don't know, talk a little bit about how is life at UAL for you, Irtiza. I know you've been there for a long time, but yeah, how have you found just becoming part of the CCI and using the facilities and all the resources that are available? Just maybe briefly talk about it. It would be useful.
I think one thing that I really love about UAL is the fact that even though you're in one particular course, you're not restricted in terms of the resources you can use. Even while in my bachelor's or things like that, like I was in an information design course, but my final project was about, so it focused more on industrial design and product design. And the fact that I could explore the skills, I had access to a 3D printer, 3D workshop, technicians. And what I could do is take skills, for example, data. So I want to visualize, for example, information. Also take technical skills and then merge them with product design and bring them together in a whole different way and package them. That's something that's very unique at UAL. You just don't gain the skills that you learn in the course. You get them from different technicians, and you can bring and form unique practices. So that's an amazing thing for me.
That's great to hear. Thanks, Irtiza. We have a question now. It says, how much one-to-one support is offered? So maybe we can hear from you, Louis, and from you, Irtiza, as well.
Yeah. So this year we have, because it's the first year, we have quite a small cohort. And in general, I don't think it's going to be a massive course in terms of like huge numbers of people. So we actually get a reasonable amount of times for all of the tutors to spend kind of time with people. I have office hours every week, which people are welcome to come and join, as do all the other tutors. What else? Yeah, so I think in general, it's quite like we've managed to actually build up a reasonable like personal relationship with quite a few people on the course already, even in the first like few weeks, which has been really nice. And yeah, we've actually towards the end of this term and the start of the new term, we are putting on some extra tutorial sessions as well. So we're trying to have as much contact time, even with the current corona situation as well.
Thanks, Louis. Also, it's worth noting as well that we have an amazing team of technicians at CCI, and you can book your slots with them. So if you're developing your own project and you need some support with that, they're amazing and they're really on it. So that's really good to note as well. Do you want to add something on that, Irti, from your experience?
My experience has been pretty good in terms of the one-on-one support. So we have like these tutorial slots that we can book with our tutors. But they're also very kind tutors, and I'm not saying that because Louis is here. I personally experienced this with both Rebecca and Louis. Like I was struggling with a few things or a few concepts that I didn't get. And like, for example, the 20-minute slot wasn't enough for me. They were kind enough to actually extend, both of them were quite kind enough to actually extend those slots for as long as I needed to clear those concepts. So they've been very helpful and accommodating. So I don't think the one-on-one support is going to be an issue for anyone.
Thanks, Irti. We have another question about portfolio and personal statement. So maybe this one could be for you, Louis. What do we want to see in a portfolio or personal statement in this case?
I want to see people that are enthusiastic about the course. I'm not necessarily as interested in the personal, in the technical skills. I'd like to see people that have interesting takes on things, and who've maybe taken part in experiencing this in either like art or music in practice. That would be cool. Engage. It's always nice to see people who've got engagement in stuff outside of their an academic environment. So if you're doing stuff working with community groups, or just generally involving in the kind of creative activity outside, I think is always going to look nice. We really, CCI in general is an amazingly diverse place, and so we welcome a really diverse set of applicants. We've got such a wide range of people, even though this particular course is pretty small, even within that we've got such a diverse range of people, and that makes me really happy.
Thanks, Louis. I think next one is for you as well. What's the cohort capacity, or how many people are on the course at the moment?
So there is 12 people on the course at the moment. I think we will take more next year. I'm not 100% sure what the upper limit is. That's probably more of an admin question. But in terms of the other courses at the other MSc courses at CCI, I think the creative computing course, which is in its second year, has 35 to 40 students on it this year. So I think probably the capacity of the course is quite large. I think it's a reasonably small cohort this year, which is nice because it's the first year. So we're kind of getting everything in order, and I think ready to expand next year.
Thanks, Louis. We have Anna also asking, what is the biggest difference between the MA Creative Computing and this MSc?
I would say the creative computing is more based around practice, I think is probably the biggest difference. I don't want to speak too much for Phoenix's course, but my experience, I've known Phoenix for a while, and she's an amazing person and a great teacher. We're probably a bit more technical, and you'll learn a lot of technical computing skills, I think, on the creative coding course as well. It's probably more in the context of creative practice rather than more like industry or vocational work. The nice thing is that they all happen in the same place. So I guess looking at question three, obviously it's hard to tell what's going to happen next year. But if we are all in the same place, that'd be amazing.
Yeah, hopefully we can. Amazing. And the other question that came through, opportunities for work placements, are there partnerships between the school and potential employers and companies at the moment?
Yep, I think there are definitely plans. So the Unit 5 is a specifically a portfolio thing where we'll get people to come in and engage from the creative industries. We've already had a few industry people come in, either talk or plan to talk this term in the language processing course. So yeah, we had someone from BBC R&D come in and chat. And we also got someone who, a guy who works, I can't remember what his company's called, but he works in the States and does lots of, he does lots of marketing for chatbots and stuff, but also lots of kind of goodwill work where he's kind of tracking down disinformation bots for the UN in terms of like cleaning up elections and stuff. So that's really nice. London itself is, there's so many creative companies and lots of people doing cool, interesting data science stuff. A lot of them who have contacts with either me or Mick Grierson or Rebecca or Ben Stouffer. So I think that both in terms of courses that people come in giving chats, then also I think once we get around to the final thesis, we'll be looking at people might do possible collaborations or work placements as well for the final research project.
Amazing, thank you, Louis. The last question we received. So considering the whole pandemic situation we're living, are there opportunities for submission extension for projects?
I can say for now, I don't know, maybe that's a question you can answer better, Georgina. We have, definitely we have a lot of extenuating circumstances based on the current pandemic situation. And also, we have a really amazing disability coordinator. So if anyone has a longer term, anything that we consider the disability, we're really, Caris is amazing at helping people for kind of match assessment criteria and get extensions or different situations where feasible.
Yeah, I would say also overall UAL has been super understanding of like everyone's particular situations, and yeah, there have been a lot of changes this year to accommodate everyone's situation. So I would say that yes, that wouldn't be an issue at all, and that wouldn't affect the course of the MSc. Also, in terms of particular scholarships, I would advise to contact a specific team within UAL who can advise on that. So I'm gonna just quickly copy paste the contact in here, and if you could reach out to them, they will be best placed to advise on that front. Okay, I hope that's useful. Okay, does anyone else have any other question? We still have 8 minutes left. Otherwise, maybe we could talk a little bit about how assessment works at the course, Louis.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no problem. So what have we got this year? The current terms, we've got some in-class assignments, so just like a portfolio of small assignments. We've got some critical, we've got an essay, a critical essay, so alongside a programming project in the language processing course. So not only do you do a kind of a technical project where you kind of do a bit of research, analyzing some language or building something interesting, we also ask people to then write a 2000 word essay and kind of situating their work and their research. So I think it's rather than just making things, there's also we assess how people can critically engage with that and also situate it within a body of work. The language processing course has had a journal club every other week. So kind of from the beginning, we're getting students to get used to reading, because it might be a new discipline for a lot of them. So we're getting people to have practice reading and discussing like scientific papers, CCI papers, so we're trying to make sure that as well as the technical skills, everyone also is engaging with the kind of research and critical thinking at the time. There's also I think at least three of the units have exams. Currently, because of Corona, they're open book online exams. I'm not sure if that will be the same next year if we're in person, but I know that, again, from Karis, who is the disability coordinator, she is pushing for, and something that I think CCI is engaging with quite well, is just generally more open exams, and like say an exam that you have a week to work on, rather than just one that you come in and sit in a room for 2 hours and do, is generally a more inclusive design for learning and a more inclusive model of assessment. Currently the exams are more like open book. I think you get a week to do them, and I'm unsure as whether will stay that way next year. But I'm certainly in favour of it. I feel the kind of by rote learning exams are not necessarily as useful as something that tests understanding.
Thanks for that, Louis. Okay, so we haven't received any more questions. Is there anything else maybe, Irtiza, you would like to share with everyone here in the meantime?
I don't think I have anything specific to share in terms of how Louis was explaining the exam. So that is, I think, one thing that quite bothered me at the start. Like, okay, there are going to be exams, and because I did my bachelor's in a different way, so I was quite worried about that. But now that I'm actually experiencing it, it's actually quite chill. And the fact that you get so much time to do these things, it's more relaxing, especially coming to a conversion master's when you have more time to sort of explore. The exams are not like exam, they're more like learning experience, because you learn like so many bits and pieces. But once you actually sit in the assignments, that is where the real learning starts, and it's more like a learn by doing approach. So I think that's one thing. And the other thing that I can add is I sort of struggled with this thing between the creative computing course and the MSc, and I think Louis explained it very well, because I talked to a lot of people, like, what's the difference between the two courses, and it's more technically focused. But there were some bits of the creative computing course that I just didn't want to let go. For example, physical computing. And one thing that I've noticed is CCI is quite flexible in terms of modules. I requested Phoenix to sort of grant me access to her physical computing module, because they were all videos and stuff. And she did. So even though I'm in this course, I'm auditing the physical computing card, because that interests me. So just one part of that course, but I get to have the best of both worlds. So they're also quite flexible if you want to learn new skills. So that's quite encouraging.
That's amazing to hear. Thanks for sharing that, Irtiza. I just shared the contact there for funding at UAL in the chat. So feel free to email them if you have any specific questions or you would like to get to know more about how funding works at UAL. Otherwise, the website that I pasted in the chat as well could be a good guide on that front.
Yeah, I might just add in another point about the technical facilities at the CCI, which is quite relevant specifically for this course. Obviously, a lot of the making stuff is useful for some of the more like practice-based courses. But the fact that they have so many machines with big old graphics cards is something which is going to be super useful when we get into some of the more heavy lifting stuff next term. And so the facilities are pretty insane, to be honest. To have access to that many like high level computers right on site is amazing. And also in terms of the technical staff, to give you an example, today someone just posted in, has anyone got any EEG sensors, which is like brain electricity sensors? And Mick was like, yeah, there's just some in my office, like, go grab some. So I think, if you the amount of kind of just institutional knowledge in the staff and students and equipment and technical facilities is just a great bunch of people. Anytime you really need to know anything or ask for like a reference for like, has anyone know any good reading about this, or any artists that are working in with like this stuff, you ask it to the group and you'll get 10 things back super quick.
Yeah, that's something I really love about CCI. The communications between every single student and member is just amazing. you have a doubt, you want to share an event or whatever that comes to you, we have Slack as a platform. So we're just like keeping updated, like every single person at the CCI about what's going on and what we're working on. So it's something, yeah, very nice about the atmosphere that we've created there. So yeah, that's really, really cool. I'm just gonna now, before we come to an end, I'm gonna paste the CCI general email on the chat. So please, if you have any further questions about this MSc or about the CCI, feel free to reach us on this address, and we'll be super happy to answer whatever question in there. And yeah, I think that's all for today. Thanks everyone who attended the session. Thanks for your amazing questions as well. And of course, thanks RT and thanks Louis for your involvement and your time, and for so kindly answering to all these queries. And yes, we have a few more sessions coming up next week. So keep an eye on our social media channels and on our Eventbrite page in case you're interested in hearing more about other courses and other opportunities out there from CCI. And yes, just a big thanks to everyone. We'll see you hopefully in person very, very soon. Thanks, yeah, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks, Georgina.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.